Many organisms can perfectly do without. Plants need no consciousness nor self-consciousness, as do many animals. Yet, they function well. Only in some higher animals like dolphins, crows, apes, and humans, we see what we call self-consciousness. Why is that? What is this enigmatic substance exactly? And what's the purpose of it? That's one of the main questions we are going to talk about in this episode on evolutionary psychology. And doing so, we will discover what consciousness actually is and how it works. And maybe some of it will disappoint you. As so often, learning about evolutionary psychology, brick by brick, tears down the concept of us being autonomous, free individuals, operating on a purely rational basis. So, if you are dearly attached to this myth, please turn off this video. Even single-cell organisms can act rationally. They can make simple decisions and are even able to learn from experience. For example, where and how to avoid danger or to find food. Being single-celled, they have no special neurons, let alone a nervous system, to be able to do this. So, structures for learning can be positioned on a level lower than single cells. We don't know exactly how, but maybe they make internal molecule representations of important aspects of their surroundings. Plants are known too to make rational decisions. Sunflowers follow the sun to attract maximum amounts of sunlight. Some plants sense water and minerals in the soil and adjust the growth of their roots accordingly. There's a multitude of research going on that shows intelligent behavior is much more widespread in nature than we used to think it is. And we have to realize part of our intelligence is based on these very basic structures too. We have genes dating back to the very beginning of cellular life. So intelligence and consciousness is not purely based in our heads. It's spread all over our body, just like in a starfish, and maybe even outside of it. In an earlier episode, we discussed the idea that, for example, a polar bear is in fact a kind of an image of its environment. By a process of reverse engineering, we can, by dissecting a dead polar bear, discover features of the Arctic region even without actually visiting it. His white color tells something about the white snow, his stomach and guts about the food he eats, his fur about the temperature in these regions, and so on. Another way of stating this is saying the polar bear wears inside of him a model of his environment, the result of ages of evolutionary adaptation. In fact, we could say this is the first step toward consciousness and self-consciousness, because as we will see, consciousness is all about models and making models, constructing internal representations of outside events and states. Evolution shows a neat path, using the same design principles over and over again, from the very first ways of adaptation to the very last, and maybe we might say the highest forms of adaptation, that is, conscious thinking. Again, as discussed in some earlier videos, we can draw a straight line from the principles used at the dawn of evolution to the principles on which the most advanced ways of reasoning take place. The essence of natural selection is the creation of variants, and selecting the most fitting ones and then copying them and applying them again. In the onset of life, the emerging of variants was caused by, in fact, destructive forces, like radiation or chemical influences, causing errors in the copying process, mutations. Destructiveness became constructive, one might say, and the error became the solution. The most simple life forms are guided by fixed behavioral schemes, reflexes and instincts, and in the onset of life, adaptation was only possible within a series of generations. The next step is trial and error learning, like the white rat in a Skinner box. He generates random behavior, of which some have positive consequences, and these ones are repeated, while the non-effective responses disappear. They die. This way, the rat can learn. He can adapt to situations for which he has no inborn fixed reflexes available. This makes him much more flexible and allows him to enter much more different environments in comparison with species with only fixed sets of responses. Thinking, as with humans, is trial and error learning in internal simulations. We generate different mental scenarios, test them out in our heads, and choose the best one. This saves human lives. Only ideas perish, not human bodies. We know big apes can do the same. Ethologists observed chimps solving complex problems, not by way of trial and error, but by sitting, seemingly doing nothing, and then suddenly becoming active and showing the final working solution. So something must have happened inside their heads, just like when they were pondering before finding a solution. Most animals can function quite well without consciousness, so it's not a prerequisite to survive. A well-balanced system of reflexes and instinct, in fact, would do fine. Even our own behavior is only for a very small part governed by intentional, conscious decisions. We are, in a way, not the CEOs of ourselves, as we often think, but at best, we are the spokesman, while the real decisions are made on completely different levels. Our prime role sometimes seems to mold all these decisions and actions in a coherent story afterwards, we only being the spin doctors dealing as good as possible with the facts randomly being thrown at us. We are the historians faced with the ominous task of writing a hero story of a messy bunch of sometimes brave, most of the time coward, selfish acts, sometimes planned, but most of the time impulsive deeds of an ever squabbling hodgepodge of multiple agents. Most famous is the research of Dr. Benjamin Libet. He showed many decisions are made, as measured by activities of our neurons, even before a person is aware of this. So these decisions were prepared or made at a deeper level than our everyday consciousness, while we'll still have the impression it were our own individual decisions. But that's part of the story too, the delusive impression believing the story is real. We may even say, just as a prisoner forced by his guard to say he stays there voluntarily, our unconscious instincts dictate us to think of ourselves as rational beings, not governed by unconscious instincts. What we consider ourselves usually matches with our physical body, especially the parts with sensory perception on it, like our skin, fingertips, eyes, etc. Normally, for example, we hardly experience what's going on in our body and organs. We are not aware of that, until, of course, problems or pain arises. Then it becomes part of our bodily awareness. But normally, this is limited and located on the skin and in other sensory receptors. But we know this sensation that belongs to us can easily be extended. For a tennis player, his racket is factually a part of his body. When you use a pen to write something down, or when you are blindfolded and use a pen to determine the shape and texture of an unknown object, we can in fact feel that object at the point of our wooden pencil. For a moment, our body, what we consider our me, is stretched a bit. It's temporarily extended to the tip of the pencil. Furthermore, sometimes other people, objects or animals become part of ourselves too. Think of a moment of ecstasy in a group, or a horseman becoming one with his animal. Its movements are his movements. For us as social animals, this experience of transcendence and extended self is so essential, it was incorporated in religious experience and rituals all over the world. It's an almost universal human phenomenon. Sometimes the information we need to act or understand what's going on comes to us in a quite remarkable way, showing the connection between the various systems we use to make sense of the world and ourselves are quite loosely coupled, consciousness being just one of them. As explained, we are in fact a collection of quite independent systems, like a number of states with on top of it the federal government with a constant debate on who is authorized to make certain decisions. Psychologist William James, and later Peter Lang, provokingly said, "We know we are afraid of a bear because we see ourselves running away from it." This seems quite counterintuitive, but in recent years, much empirical evidence has been gathered to support this idea. Let's have a look at some of the more intriguing material of this. For instance, researchers had groups of people watch movies. Some watched funny movies, other emotional or scary ones. These groups were split into two conditions, a natural one and a group secretly administered stimulants like high doses of caffeine, making their blood pressure rise and their heartbeat go faster. After seeing the movie, they were asked to rate the movie, and then a remarkable difference appears between the drugged and the non-drugged group. the first reported the movies as much more intense in comparison to the non-drug control group, be it more funny, more hilarious, more scary, or more romantic. So apparently, without realizing it, they consulted their bodies to make an assessment on how they experienced the movie. If my heart is beating in an unusual high rate, this must be because the movie was very scary, very amusing, or very romantic. While for the non-drug group, this was only an average scary, amusing, or romantic business as usual, nothing special kind of movie. The same result showed an experiment where males had to interact with a female they had never met before. In one condition, the males had just walked over a high, scary, wobbly bridge. In the other condition, this was not the case. Immediately after this, they were asked to rate the sexiness of the female. And here we see the same effect. Aroused males rated the girl as more sexy and exciting as non-aroused males did. So again, they implicitly consulted their body on how to cognitive assess a certain situation. People with lesions in their spinal cord experience less or no emotions at all. When something bad happens, a loved one dies, they know they should be sad, but they do not experience or feel sadness as we do. Although they can still think rationally, all emotional color is washed away out of their lives. So we need mind, body and soul to really proper live, feel and think. Implicitly, most people think of themselves as a little me, an homunculus, living somewhere inside their heads. For most people, somewhat behind their eyes. And this being the center of experience, feeling and thinking. This is experienced as the core element of the self, the CEO we think we are. Besides the logical flaws in this idea, is there another homunculus inside the little homunculus? And again, another in an even smaller homunculus? And how far does this regression go? Infinite? It doesn't match with all the data we have on this complicated issue of consciousness and self-consciousness. Reality is, we are more like a messy parliament of voices, constantly battling, shouting and squabbling. Sometimes the one is winning, another time the other voice is dominating. You are not alone in your head, we could say. You are a multitude of personalities. Or one could express it completely the other way around, as did Daniel Dennett. When you look inside, there is nobody there, he said. Meaning, there is not one central unit of control and command. Ourselves is for the biggest part just a useful illusion. And to make myself clear, there's no reason to abandon it. God and Santa Claus are useful illusions too, just as the state, money and the law are. And these are all very useful things most of the time for most of the people. And here again, we stumble on the same core message of evolutionary thinking we have already met so many times and expressed in so many ways before. And that is, you don't need a central, all-wise and all-powerful unit to make good decisions or to create complex order. No, in reality, order almost always does emerge not top-down, but bottom-up, by a process of many evolutionary interactions between vast numbers of smaller systems. Charles Darwin applied this idea to biology. Adam Smith called it the invisible hand in economics, and the earliest thinkers on artificial intelligence, like Oliver Selfridge, experimented with competing subsystems without one central system in command. Modern psychologists more and more realize this is also the best way to look at consciousness, intelligence and creativity. In our head, we are with many. When you study an individual ant or termite in a laboratory, out of its natural environment, separated from its colony, you will never discover the real essence of this tiny creature. Together, they are capable of building the most complex structures. They can find food of the right sort and of the right amounts, and do many other highly complex things. But the knowledge for this, you will never find in one single termite or ant. Their truly great feats are always of a collective origin. By numerous interactions, variants, wrong decisions, corrected, trial and error, and subtle exchanges of information, they can, for example, build these vast complex structures scientists still haven't unraveled the finer details of. Just so are our neurons. Every single neuron cell is quite simple, a bit dumb in fact, and not capable of doing great things. But together, interacting and evolving, they can do wonderful things. But there is no one cell nor a group of cells that constitutes the all-important central unit. There's no king, no god, no central planning agency, no soul, no me, no little homunculus, no CEO at the top of the pyramid. Only evolution made possible by many entities interacting in a messy and complex way. So stop seeing yourself as a single unit, as a oneness, as I. That's just the story you yourself like to believe for social purposes. I will come to that in a minute. Reality is, you, every momentary state you are in, is a compromise of many forces, many subpersonalities, some conscious, many non-conscious. Just like nature is a self-organizing system, working with the all-powerful principles of evolution, so is our brain, or better, our body, or better, the supersystem of which we are part of, interacting with other parts. Because we are all termites, part of a termite colony, unable to function and survive without this supersystem. And yes, we can refer to this supersystem by the name of God. In one of his books, Jared Diamond tells about the way hunter-gatherer groups live together. One of the things that struck him was that we are constantly talking to each other, even about the most trivial things, for hours on end without stopping. It drove Diamond almost mad at times. But maybe we must see these groups as one organism, as one system, one brain, with constant interaction between the parts, making sense of all the things around and within them, solving problems, thinking about solutions for past and future problems, and doing so outsmarting every single genius thinking he can solve things on his own. In the episodes 4 and 5 of this YouTube series, we discussed the way new innovations take place, and we discovered it's almost always by way of collective interactions. The idea of one great genius coming up with something completely new is just a myth. Okay, but let's go back to consciousness and self-consciousness. As many species can perfectly well do without, where and how did it become into existence? The most intriguing species that can help us clarify this question is the vampire bat. These little animals live in big colonies in caves. At night they fly out and every individual starts looking for prey, big mammals of which he can suck blood. If one such bat succeeds, he flies back to his cave. At the dawn of morning, every others do too. Some found blood, while many of the little Draculas, and their numbers are always quite big, unfortunately did not. And that's a huge problem. These tiny animals have a very high metabolism and can last for only about 70 hours without food. Then they die. So the solution vampire bats came up with was to share blood. Sometimes you caught more than you needed and you gave some to a begging neighbor. Sometimes it was the other way around and you could rely on others to save your life. A social security system, helping all. Great. But unfortunately, such generous systems never last long. For a single individual, game theory predicts, it's always beneficial to abuse it. Do not flying out at night, because this is always dangerous, and waiting till morning and then receiving free blood. As long as one in 10,000 bats show such bad attitudes, it's no problem. But when many do, it indeed becomes a number one obstacle for the survival of the whole of the colony. Because after many generations, ever increasing numbers will act as free riders. Why? Simply because their survival rate is bigger. They never face the dangerous leaving the safe cave and going out hazardous hunting tours. This way, a genetically fixed bad habit spreads around the colony like a pandemic virus, and it will in the end mean, after a number of generations, the extinction of the group. So evolution had to respond by looking for ways to prevent cheating. One of these preventive measures was growing bigger brains in the vampire bat. This for several reasons. First of all, bats learn to recognize and remember each other as individuals. Second, they evolved a superior memory for how much blood they gave, to whom, and from which other bat they received blood in approximately what amounts. They became skilled bookkeepers. Third, just like capuchin monkeys and many other species, they developed a strong instinct for justice. Okay, it's all right to give, but in the long run, I have to receive back too, in about the same amount as I have given. This way, cheaters and free riders could be unmasked, and you yourself could prevent becoming a sucker. But as armed raids have a tendency never to stop, so did this one. Later generations of bots discovered ever more clever new ways to evade the defense mechanisms of their peers. Bats focused on thinking of ever more creative strategies to deceive others, while at the same time not being detected for this yourself. Abuse, but don't get abused yourself. Humans are hunters too. They also share meat, because being successful at a particular hunt is always uncertain. So just like with bats, a social security system is best for the group. But it will inevitably too attract free riders. And just as bats, we devise defense mechanisms for this. And just like with the vampires, it's always profitable to find a way to evade even the most cleverly designed defense systems by an even more advanced way of cheating. A never-ending arms race emerged, leading to ever bigger brains and what we now call consciousness and self-consciousness. Many evolutionary psychologists and anthropologists believe our bigger, big brains, superior intelligence, and high degree of self-consciousness have to do with this everlasting arms race. Cheating, preventing becoming a victim of cheating, and finding ways to maximize your profit in this mad game. Keep this essential process in mind when you hear the coming parts of the story. We are pre-programmed to see ourselves in a very specific way, probably inborn, because it's universal in all of humanity. And that is, we see ourselves as an entity with consciousness, feeling, intentions, reasoning ability, and a multitude of values, like wanting food and safety and avoiding danger. These features are for us quite self-evident. We experience them in our inner world, but we project them on others too. This is called theory of mind, TOM. The idea that others have mental states too, can think and feel just as we can. Sometimes we stretch our projections of this a bit too far. A little kid hurting himself by colliding with a table thinks the table is bad and purposely caused pain on him. Dog lovers routinely project all kinds of human feature on their pets. Some forms of religion probably found its origin in us seeing forces in nature, like animals, seasons, storms, rivers, etc., as personalities, being benevolent or malicious, so as intentional agents. We attribute TOM to them. Furthermore, we have TOM and we know others have TOM too. So we are able to look at ourselves as others do. We can take their perspective and think what they think about us, a kind of higher order self-perception. We are conscious of our sensory information input and we can consciously conscious of our consciousness of this. And this can even be pushed another or even more levels higher. So being aware of ourselves, including our being aware of our awareness of ourselves, is a fundamental characteristic of our unique mental state and a cornerstone of what we call self-consciousness. In our mind, we run simulations with others as well as with ourselves as the prime actors, all playing a part in the role. In humans, maybe foremost in humans, these higher level models also influence what is happening on lower levels. For example, on what we experience in what way. We all know expectations, for example, usually shape our perceptions. You probably know this little trick about the numbers 12, 13 and 14, or the letters A, B and C. Or the picture in which some see an old lady, while others perceive a young one. It's all about seeing what you expect to see. Our models guiding us to what and how we perceive reality. As philosopher Heinz von Förster once said, the world as we perceive it is our own invention. Of all animals, man is the most dedicated model maker and storyteller. We are always busy making theories about the world and about ourselves, and we constantly seek validation for them, partly in ourselves, we match new models with existing ones, part in calibrating on external sources like others and reality. Language is tightly related to us making abstract concepts. Making concepts, that is putting a multitude of individual perception into one coherent category, is quite universal. Young lions recognize other lions, even when they have never met this specific individual lion before. They instinctively know it belongs to a certain category. Young human infants are capable of discriminating males from females and cats from dogs. They know a Chihuahua is a dog, just like a Great Dane, and that a pony is not a Great Dane, even if it has the same size. Even without language or learning, we can use abstract concepts. It's inborn. Only people and some highly intelligent animals can link these concepts to abstract symbols, like icons, signs, or sounds, that is, words. This usually enhances our ability of thinking together, and by self-talk perform even more enhanced stimulation in our own heads. We are model makers. We always react on the models in our head, not on the reality as it factually is. Good models make us take good decisions, but as well, bad ones make us make bad decisions. The most important realization you have to make in your life is that the model isn't reality itself. It's useful, just like a map of a city you have never visited before, but in the words of the famous Polish philosopher Alfred Korzybski, the map of the city is not the city itself. When I say this, it will probably sound quite self-evident to you, but mixing up these two concepts is the origin of the greatest suffering of mankind and of individual people. This is also why the human species, of all species, is most prone to madness, defined as having a model of the world that is not helping you. Psychotherapy is all about investigating, discussing and improving your maps and models of the world and of yourself. It was Gordon Gallup who devised the so-called self-recognition test. When you paint a big yellow dot on the forehead of a chimp while narcotized, and he afterwards walks along a mirror, he sees the yellow dot and immediately realizes the dot is on his own forehead. He knows the ape in the mirror is he himself. For animals not passing the test, they just think they see another individual. A dog barks on it like it barks on any other unknown dog he meets. Never he realizes he's barking at his own image. Passing the self-recognition test is seen as a proof of self-consciousness. Besides chimps and humans, a limited number of other highly intelligent and social animals pass the test. Notably, dolphins, elephants, big apes, magpies and crows do. So, this highly esteemed feature of us clearly has a social role. We can run all kinds of mental simulation in our heads. Social simulations. If I do this, how will my friend react? And if I want to react him in a certain way, what should I do? Originally, as I explained, this was all about cheating to get away with it and not being cheated yourself. Over time, however, it evolved to all kinds of other social situations as well. For example, being able to show empathy, solve and prevent conflicts, and create effective ways of cooperation. We can think about the needs and talents of others and how to persuade them to use them in the intended way. So its application grew ever broader and formed the cornerstone of the most advanced form of cooperation seen in the universe, the human ability to work together. But back to the processes that govern consciousness. As told, we can run higher order simulations, like I think he thinks that I think he's stupid. So before we really act, we can investigate the effects of all kinds of social scenarios and pick the one that best suited our goals. Foremost, it is a way of manipulating our social image. Evolutionary psychologists have discovered. And don't underestimate this point. Most of our thinking and interacting is just about this one specific topic. The famous psychologist Robin Dunbar found out most of our informal talking is gossip, telling each other about the traits, strengths and weaknesses of others, who to trust and cooperate with and whom to avoid. Our self-story is what we tell other people about ourselves and of the things we hope they will tell in the same way to others. This way building up the desired public image, which appears to be very important in receiving help, social support and mating partners. One of the core effects of consciousness is our ability of self-perception, of creating models of which we ourselves are part of too. But one could argue this is logically impossible, because you cannot store a box and his surrounding in a box of the same size. That's true. But here, our inborn ability for abstractions comes in, which in fact is a clever way of data reduction, making things smaller while for us they look the same size. We do, for example, think we have vivid memories of something happening yesterday. Fact is, you only remember some simple cues and all the other information is recreated the moment you activate the memory. Elizabeth Loftus showed this with some ingenious experiments, where people say they remembered all kinds of details of short movies they had seen the day before. But in fact, all the reported details were missing, but did make logical sense with the cues used. For example, the windows of a car were not smashed, but because of the fact that the car was in a heavy accident, it was inferred the windows were broken. Most famous, of course, is the inattentional blindness experiment by Simon and Chablis. Subjects watched a short movie having the task to count the number of times people throw the ball to each other. Not very difficult, but nevertheless, it requires that much attention that the majority of the subjects is unaware of a big man dressed in a gorilla suit, stopping in the middle of the scene, aggressively beating his chest and moving on. Many subjects just didn't notice the gorilla. Unbelievable when you first see it. But it shows people are only aware of a very small part of their visual fields. Most of the things they think they see are not observed at all, but only filled in from models we have of what we expected to see. Now, the next crucial question is, what information that enters our senses is really entering our mind and incorporated in our models? And which information is neglected? We as story makers are in fact driven by four prime motives. We can view them as a kind of gatekeepers. Every moment in our lives we are bombarded by a vast amount of information. The biggest part does not enter us and is filtered away. Luckily so, because if not, we would be completely overloaded, like a DDoS attack on a computer. Psychologists Sedikides and Strube identified four important motives or gatekeepers. Our need for accurate objective information, our need for information to enhance our skills, relevant knowledge and competencies, our need for status and self-enhancement, and fourth, our need for consistency. I will illustrate them one by one. First of all, there is of course our need for accurate information. We need to know how to deal with challenges in our environment. The models in our head need to be accurate, have to be good reflections of the external state of affairs. If not, we would make the wrong decisions, and in the wild this can often mean our death. The need for true information is of course quite self-evident, but it's surely not the only one and can at times be dominated by some other of the motives. Closely related to this first driver, we often need skills to survive we don't yet master at this moment. Therefore, we have a natural urge to learn. Young kids already show a strong interest in the things older people do. They want to learn by copying their behavior and practice relevant skills. When you look at play, be it with animals or with humans, this always shows things youngsters need later in life. Young deer practice escaping. Young lions learn stealth, attacking and killing. So we have a keen eye for information that enhances our future survival skills. The third essential motive is our need for self-enhancement. We've showed this in a number of times before. Status is of the utmost essence, especially to males in the ages they start procreating. Polygamy creates fierce competition between males, manifesting itself in direct battle and competition, but also in collecting status to impress females. Just like peacocks, we want to show how magnificent we are, and a bit of lying is no uncommon sin in this. We are always busy creating a story in which we are the good guy. Believing this yourself is the first step in making other people believe your story too. It will be clear we sometimes have to manipulate the truth a bit, or to be creative and selective in the way we handle information. The burglar in court will depict himself as a kind of Robin Hood. Research shows 80% of the people rank themselves in the top 20% of many important traits, like honesty, leadership skills, civil behavior, etc. Groups select new members, and of course they want the very best. If your teammates play well, you are more likely to win the game too, in case of team sports, and most activities we perform as hunter-gatherers were team activities, team sports. So new members have to sell themselves. And just like the peacock, pretending you are a bit better than you actually are pays off. Don't exaggerate, because this will unmask you, but a little bit will serve you well. Ingenious research showed self-enhancement is a kind of natural reflex for us. We do it automatically. It is being self-critical, which will cost you the most mental energy. Asking people questions about themselves while they perform a demanding task makes them less self-critical. When they perform a routine task, which absorbs no mental energy, they are better able to analyze themselves in a critical way. This effect being stronger in America compared to Europe. The last driving motive is the need to be consistent. This motive is founded on a number of underlying mechanisms. Cognitive consistency models depict it as a need in itself. People strive for it, and that's all. I think there's more to say about it. I think it has to do with us being social animals, living and working in groups. If not predictable in our behavior, it makes it very hard for others to accept us as partners. If you are never sure about your mates, you can never take dangerous actions or do risky things. So, to accommodate to this need of the group we belong to, we want to be consistent, that is, predictable, in both our thinking and in our behavior. Research shows heightened self-awareness occurs when we know others are observing us, or when we see ourselves in a mirror, or when we are aware of being filmed. People more rigidly stick to their norms, that is, they become more consistent. So people believing non-aggression is better become more peaceful, while people for which assertiveness or aggressiveness is a big part of their self-concept or group identity become more violent. It's like we are being aware others are judging us, and we put some extra effort in showing off. Of course, self-consciousness is a very elaborate topic, and I could tell you much more about it, for it touches very fundamental issues like free will and autonomy, and for example, the provocative idea whether we have ideas or whether we better understand our world to see ideas as the essential building blocks and we just being locations or vehicles they use, us being parking garages for ideas, manipulating us without even noticing this. Maybe these are nice topics for some future videos. For now, thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and see you on the next video in our series on evolutionary psychology. Goodbye.